everyone, to the 198th meeting of the New York Linux Users Group. This is the latest in our regular monthly meetings. Tonight we are going to be hearing about, and I hope I've worded this well, the critical importance of open source from a perspective that I suspect most of us haven't thought deeply about before, and that is, what does it mean to have your life depend on code? It goes a little more broadly than that, but that should give you along with the title and the blurb on Meetup, some insight into what this is. Karen Sandler will tell us about her experience in her talk, Freedom in My Heart. I'd like to say how much we appreciate Bloomberg for sponsoring us with this space and with the food and drink outside. And I'd like to thank you, everyone who's shown up here, taking this opportunity to come and join us tonight. Tonight, before we get started, we have our usual requests. Silence your cell phones first. Next, do not eat snacks and noisy wrappers during the presentation. A little less of a risk here, but if you did bring something or whatever, please find a way to eat it silently or wait until the presentation is done. I will have this microphone for questions. I believe I forgot to ask about this. Is it all right to hold questions until the end? So yeah, hold questions until the end or until Karen asks for questions. We'll bring the mic to you. That way, we will have the questions on the recording. And I'll come around and wherever you are and bring the mic. Great. I'd like to thank our regular space sponsor again, Bloomberg, and acknowledge our other sponsors past and present, IBM, Canonical, Brandor Group, Google, and O'Reilly Media for their support. In addition, NYLUG runs on our volunteers and other people who participate, so thank you everyone who helps out. That's really important to us. I do want to mention that our next regular meeting will feature Daniel Walsh on how to make containers actually contain, which will be Thursday, October 8th. I hope you are all interested in that as well. First of the announcements I'll have, we have workshops resuming. Ask Hannah if you have any questions, but the gist of it is they will be happening at City College at 138th in Amsterdam. The next workshop will be September 22nd from 6 to 8 p.m., and they will be up on the Meetup page again pretty soon, I think, if they're not there already. In case you missed it, you can grab a Linux distro DVD from the back windowsill over there. You have your choice of various Linux distros on DVD. If you haven't tried one but want to, they are there for you to pick up and take with you. Let's see. Audience announcements.
Just briefly, those of you who've been here regularly there, you'll know my talk. We're doing Container Days on October 29th, 30th. Very topical given the next upcoming talk here. Look it up on Eventbrite. It's basically a two-day DevOps days for containers, so to speak. It's some talks, it's some open spaces, it's some workshops. One particularly OSV, like system-related one, we're having the head of the Cryo project, Checkpoint Restore and User Space, come and talk about that, basically space and time travel for containers. I'm really excited about that, and you can look at the abstract online.
Here, just to announce a related meetup, there's a Red Hat Users Group that we formed for New York City. Our third meeting will be October the 14th, which is the second Wednesday of October. We don't have all our talks confirmed yet. We're not as well organized as NYLUG is yet, but right now the plan is to for the October talks to have a Kickstarter talk and an LVM caching talk. So anybody that's interested, there's a meetup link, and I'll put it in the comments on the meetup page.
Any other announcements? Okie doke. So now please welcome Karen Sandler with her talk, Freedom in My Heart. Come on up.
Thanks. Hi, everybody. My name's Karen Sandler. I'm the executive director of the Software Freedom Conservancy. So these are my, that's my Twitter handle and Conservancy's Twitter handle. And I'll be at the bar later if you want to talk about the intricacies of whether it's a great idea to use Twitter or not. and so we can talk about that. But as I said, I'm a patient. And I'm a patient because I literally have a big heart. My heart is three times the size of a normal person's heart. The condition is called hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. Saying I have a big heart is a little bit of an exaggeration. It's like a very thick heart, and so it means that the walls are very thick. And I'm asymptomatic. It actually was extremely coincidental that I even found out that I had this condition. I was getting migraines And so I went in to a neurologist, and through that whole process, I found out I had a murmur, and on top of the murmur, oh, I also happen to have this condition. So it was kind of funny. I'm completely asymptomatic. And so going into finding out about this heart condition, I was sort of like, well, I feel fine, and you know, what's the story? And the only problem is that with this heart condition, there is a very high risk of sudden death. The doctors actually call it sudden death. Like, that's the medical term, which seemed really crazy to me. But I have like a 2-3% chance per year compounding of suddenly dying. And I was diagnosed at age 31. So this was extremely stressful to find out. And I'm sitting there in an electrophysiologist's office, which is a kind of cardiologist, and I'm sitting there with my mother, of course, and the doctor told me not to worry because you can get a defibrillator. And you know, he keeps a bunch of these doctors, they keep the defibrillators in their desks. They have like a bunch of samples that the medical device companies give them so that they can hand them out to you, and he slips it across the desk. And they do this because they want you to see how small it is, how light it is, how non-threatening it is, you know. And so they say, hold it, pick it up, see, it's not a big deal. And so I took it, and the first question I asked was, what does it run? And he looked at me like I had two heads. My mother looked at me like I had two heads. And I said, well, he said, run, what are you talking about? And I said, well, this defibrillator has software on it. It depends on, like, what is this? What do you expect this defibrillator to do for me? And he said, oh, well, it's just going to monitor you. And when you get into trouble, if you go into sudden death, it will shock you. You know, it'll be like clear. And and it'll be fine because you'll have this defibrillator. And I was like, well, how do you think it will know when to deliver those shocks? It's monitoring it with software. Can you tell me about the software on this device? And I was a lawyer at the Software Freedom Law Center at the time, so you know, I had software on my mind. And he said, software? So we talked about it for a little bit, and then he said, okay, nobody has asked me about software on these devices in the entire time. I implant, you know, thousands of these per, you know, sometimes more than one per day, and I'm implanting these all the time. Nobody has asked me about the software. But I see your point, so I'm going to go and ask the representative of Medtronic. He's here today. You're in luck. So he says, Tom, he calls out in the hallway. And this guy comes in, he's a rep for Medtronic, and he comes into the office, and he's like, you know, lounging, like, you know, what are you going to ask me? You know, I guess this happens sometimes. And I said, can you tell me about the software on this device? And he said, software? Nobody had ever asked him about the software on the defibrillator before either. And he said, but don't worry. You know, I said, well, you know, I have a software background. I was a developer. Knowing that this device is going to be implanted in my body, I would really like to take a look at it. I'd like to find out more about it. I'd like to know as much as I can, because this is going to be literally screwed into my heart. And he said, don't worry. The company will tell you all the information you need to know. Here's the number. So I dutifully called, and I went through phone tree after phone tree after phone tree, and of course, I couldn't get any information about the software. I called the other medical device manufacturers. There are like three major ones. I called them all, and I had the same thing happen to me. I had a promising lead on one of these. one of the people in the call tree cycle connected me to an engineering group, which was great, but then they were apparently on a retreat for the week. And then mysteriously, when they got back, nobody ever called me back, despite the messages that I left repeatedly. And it was a really interesting experience. I even tried to call legal at these companies and say that I would sign a non-disclosure agreement so that I could personally see the software on my device. And of course, I got nowhere. And so time passed, and I have a couple of friends here in the audience who knew me at the time, and I just kept putting it off. But every month that I put it off, I was in danger of suddenly dying. And I went with a friend to brunch one day, and she said, so how's that whole defibrillator thing going? And I was like, yeah, I'm really freaked out about the software, so I guess I'm not really thinking about it. And she just started to cry. And she said, what are you doing? Like, this is your life. I know you care about software and software freedom, but this is, you need to get this device, because when I call you and you don't answer the phone, I'm worried that it's because you're dead. And so I realized I really needed to get this device. So this is, for people who don't know, this is Bill Gates as a Borg. So I decided that I should actually get this device and become a cyborg lawyer. Terrifying, isn't it? I really wish, I tell people that I actually have sparks that can fly out from my fingers, but I'm not gonna comment whether that's true or not, actually. But I decided that as part of getting this device that I would get it, but that I would then undertake a lot of research afterwards. And actually was lucky enough to be able to incorporate this into my job at the time. So I did a lot of research on the situation behind software and software safety and software freedom. And what I found out was, no pun, shocking. What I found out was that the FDA does not actually review the software on these devices. They don't typically review the code, so they're not even asking for the source code to review it, which means that they don't even have a copy, generally. And they don't even have a clear set of requirements for what the software should be. There are recommendations and guidelines. The FDA is working on some publications on new cybersecurity rules, but they're also problematic. But they're not in place yet. And there was one time when I gave a talk when I first found out, started talking about this, where I was on a panel with the head of cybersecurity at the FDA, and I put this up, and I was so nervous because he was right there in the audience before our panel, and I was like, correct me if I'm wrong, but the FDA doesn't do any of these things, right? And he was like, oh, no, we don't review the source code. We don't have the resources to do it. It's just not part of what we do. I also found out something that won't surprise any of you, which is that software has bugs, right? And the Software Engineering Institute, actually in a study, estimated that for every 100 lines of code, one defect is introduced. That's a lot of bugs. I looked at a lot of studies on software failures in medical devices, and man, that was really depressing. I had already gotten my defibrillator at that point, so it was a long process of doing the research, because every time I would read about the software failures and the problems with the problems that related to software and the people who died from those problems, I would get so ill that I had to put the research aside and then come back to it later when I was more refreshed, because it was so depressing. And there was one study that was particularly interesting to me, because they looked at software failures. And so of the software failures that were analyzed that they could tell were definitely software related, 98% of those would have been detected with all pairs testing. I mean, the situation is pretty bleak. And there was this really cool study that was done by a group of academics. So this is it's a bag of bacon. And in the bacon, they implanted a defibrillator. And then they basically used just regular equipment, like nothing special, and were able to take control of these devices, of the defibrillator, very much like my own, quite readily. Actually, when this study came out, I called my electrophysiologist, because actually I had been talking about this, but I hadn't quite gotten my device yet, I said, now do you believe me? And he said, FDA, Medtronic assured me that this isn't a problem. And I was like, oh, so the manufacturer assures you it's not a problem. Okay. But because of that, I was able to find a new electrophysiologist. And my new electrophysiologist said, okay, I understand what you're saying now, and I am going to call around and find you an old defibrillator. So if you guys are trying to interfere with my defibrillator now, it won't work. Because I have a really old one that had no wireless capability. So you can talk to it with magnetic coupling. So that was one interesting. They were able to take control of the device. They were able to get all kinds of information off of the devices, like social security numbers and doctor's names. And they were able to deliver unwanted shocks. And perhaps most dangerously, they were able to put the devices in test mode, which means that if it's in test mode, it's constantly running queries, and therefore the battery runs down really fast. And these devices are only as good as their battery life. So as soon as your battery runs down, you need a completely new piece of equipment. It's surgery. They otherwise last like 10 to 12 years. And in testing mode, they can run out quite quickly. I started talking about this, and does anyone know who this guy is? Yeah, it was Barnaby Jack, who died mysteriously about a year or two ago. And he's famous for, so his name was Barnaby Jack, and so he was famous for taking control of ATMs and getting them to spit out money. And when he did that, he had the display flash jackpot, because his last name was Jack, and they called it jackpotting. And he was already known for sort of working on showing how vulnerable these different software was in different contexts that we counted on. And he heard me sort of talking about this, and he was like, oh, medical devices. And so he ran off and did all this amazing work, and he was able to show that in a public place, you could, using nothing but an iPhone, collect a serial number off of the off of somebody's device who was walking around, like in a mall or something, and then deliver a fatal dose or a lethal dose or a fatal shock, depending on what the device was, just using ordinary equipment in a public place. Security through obscurity just doesn't work. It's funny because it seems counterintuitive. This is a really savvy audience, so I won't belabor this point, but it seems counterintuitive to a lot of people. You think that by publishing the source code to something that that it will become less, it will become more vulnerable because it's reviewable, and therefore people can find exploits. But these studies show, and experts agree, that that actually closed source software, proprietary software, is also vulnerable. And well, actually, I'll get to that. I'm jumping the gun here. And while these devices have the worst of both worlds, right? Their software is closed and proprietary, so we can't review them for bugs. We can't check them. But also, they have no proper encryption on them. So right now, there's no encryption on this device. My device is not broadcasting wirelessly, but almost all of the devices are that are manufactured now. And they have no real encryption on them. So it's like the worst of both worlds, which is really baffling. And because of the DMCA, the Digital Millennium Copyright Act, once the medical device companies start doing the right thing and start putting real security on these devices, doing research to do these tests that Barnaby and that academic consortium did could potentially be a crime, a felony, under the Digital Millennium Copyright Act, which is really, really crazy. I've actually participated in a exemption request to the DMCA that's ongoing right now. A bunch of us who are medical device researchers have asked for the DMCA to put an exception for medical devices and for research just to test their safety, because otherwise there's a really gray legal landscape for people. It's very chilling for people who would want to do the safety research on them. And it's really interesting because just this past week, the FDA responded to us and raised all of these fear, uncertainty, and doubt about people accessing and modifying medical devices without acknowledging how vulnerable these devices already are. But of course, it's not just medical devices, right? Once you get to the point where you realize that your life is reliant on this software and how vulnerable and how dangerous it is and how unsafe it is and how much safer it would be with free and open source software, it's a very short walk to cars. And there have been some famous car exploits recently. This was one of the first. A premium class car has about 100 million lines of code in it, and I think that it's only gotten more. And that means if you think about the Software Engineering Institute's estimate of one bug per 100 lines of code, even if the vast majority of bugs are found and fixed, that leaves a lot of bugs. But I really loved this slide that came from, this is actually from their published study. And in this study, you can notice that the car thinks that it's going 140 miles per hour, but it's in park. And then it has a little display that says, pwned by car shark. Car sharked, which I also love. And there was a recent one that got a lot of attention on Reddit and stuff of having, I think it was a Jeep that was remotely controlled and had an issue on the highway. But there's also a really cool video you could check out of the Prius hack where there's a journalist who they have in the driver's seat and they have like two guys sort of sitting in the back kind of controlling it. And he's driving and trying to accelerate the car or brake the car, and they're totally doing other things with the car, which is amazing. And you know, once you're at cars, you think about voting machines and stock markets and everything else that we rely on. And of course now we're going towards an Internet of Things, where everything is talking to everything else. So there are a lot of people who keep track of their fitness on their phone. You know, you keep track of what you eat and what your exercise regime is. And there's a trend towards doing things like coordinating those with people who have insulin pumps, that information. And if we're doing all of this on an iPhone platform, all of a sudden you have Apple connecting to your insulin pump? Craziness. You have your refrigerator talking to your security system. And in all of these things, we're only as safe as our weakest link, right? So when people are trying to show vulnerabilities in cars, they don't go straight for the brake system, right? They go through the entertainment system, or in that one, the wheel maintenance system, right? Where the wheels, where the car is broadcasting to dealers about whether or not you have enough air in your car. I mean, this is New York City. I've never owned a car in my life, but but it's still terrifying, because you realize that it's the weakest part, and where all of our software is talking to all of our other software, we have no idea which of it is life and society critical. We don't even know what's critical, because everything talks to everything else. I don't want to rely on software I can't look at. I don't want my life to rely on software I can't look at. And I don't want, in a world where everything is talking to everything else, I don't even know what part of that I need to be worried about. So in my world, in my view, everything has to be free and open source software. Because with free and open source software, we can all look at the code and see what's wrong. We can all fix it if there are problems. We don't have to wait for a Microsoft or an Apple or whatever, a Medtronic, to first admit that there's a problem and then do something to fix it. And it means that we don't have to depend on only a single party. Like, I don't necessarily, I mean, to be fair, I have a Medtronic device and I chose them because, we talk about what medical devices we choose, but if we're honest, the doctors are really the consumers on the medical devices. Patients aren't usually making the decisions about which brands that we choose. I could have probably insisted with my doctor that I go with a different brand, which I would have done if one of the manufacturers had let me review the code. But the doctor who, the electrophysiologist that I talked to, recommended Medtronic because they were very responsive, they felt confident, they have a long operating history. I have been happy with my Medtronic device, and I'm grateful to have it because now I can, you know, run across the street, catch a subway without worrying that I'm going to suddenly die doing that, and that's really great. But at the same time, I don't want to have to wait for a Medtronic tech to, for example, as you can see, I'm pregnant. last time I was, this is the second time I'm pregnant, and I don't normally talk about this, but the last time I was pregnant, I was inappropriately shocked by my device, twice. And, you know, not a lot of pregnant women have defibrillators. Not, like, what happens to women normally during pregnancy is not necessarily accounted for in the algorithms in defibrillators. And you know, if I wanted to, I would like to be able to hire medical professionals to address my own health situation instead of being in a category with mostly older people of a certain demographic, right? I talked to a high-risk obstetrician last week who told me that I'm the only patient she has ever seen with a defibrillator. And she is a New York City high-risk obstetrician. If anyone would be seeing pregnant patients with defibrillators, it would be her. So I'm not even in the category. And the idea that I have to make a business case to Medtronic or a case for me individually that my situation is important is crazy. I should be able to hire whoever I want if I had the resources or fix things myself if I needed to. Also, free and open source software is fun. but it's better and safer over time, and all studies have shown that. There's this thing called the honeymoon effect that I read about recently, which I wish were drinks on the beach, but unfortunately, not so much. So if you look at the graph of the number of bugs over time in a software project, it's generally decreasing. There's like it's decreasing, and there's a little like uptick at the end. But generally, as you would expect, the number of bugs in a software project decreases because as people work on the project, as it becomes more mature, bugs are fixed. But this study looked at vulnerabilities over time. And as you can see in the graph, looking at vulnerabilities, there's a period of time where no vulnerabilities are known or detected or exploited. So, and then once one is found, it increases quite rapidly. And they looked at free and open source software, and they looked at proprietary software. And it turns out that that both have the same trend. With free and open source software, they call this flat period the honeymoon period, and that's why they call it the honeymoon effect, because there's a period of time, due to social reasons, due to a number of reasons they postulate, they don't know why, there's a period of time where there are no vulnerabilities in code, you know, that are identified in code. And the honeymoon period in free and open source software is longer, and also the graph doesn't climb as steeply on the you know, when they're discovered. But what this tells me is that it's not today that we need to worry about our vulnerabilities. It's not when the products are just released, right? It's somewhere down the road. And that could be a day, it could be a month, it could be years. And a lot of products are on the market for a really long time, like cars or my defibrillator, which I hope will last a long time. And so down the road, you might not have a good relationship with whatever software vendor you hired at the time. They may not be in business anymore, which means that if you don't have access to the code that you've built, whatever it is you've built on, you're in trouble. If there's a vulnerability, you're not going to be able to fix it. So while we're relying on devices and software to do everything, what do we expect from the companies that are making these, you know, what are making them? To me, you know, I think it's an ethical concern and a basic business sense decision to go with software that you as a company or you as a creator have control over. And what kind of world do we really want to build? I mean, you know, I feel that you don't get an opportunity to really speak visibly pregnant that much, so I'm referencing it more than once. But you know, I want to say, think of the children. but it's a serious thing of, you know, we're building all of this infrastructure. We're building infrastructure around all of our basic societal infrastructure, and we're choosing proprietary solutions. We're choosing solutions we can't fix, and we're choosing things that are very short-sighted. So I'm using my cyborg lawyer powers for good. I moved to a non-legal role because I realized that if we don't have good solutions, if we don't have good alternatives that are free and open, no one is going to switch to free and open source software. So I'm executive director of the Software Freedom Conservancy. We are an umbrella organization for over 30 free and open source software projects. Actually, so you probably have You raise your hand if you recognize and name maybe Git or Samba or Wine or and we've got Inkscape, and so we've got tons of Sugar Labs, which is the software for one laptop per child, and actually QEMU has joined since since this slide was made. So we've got a lot of projects, but these are all projects that want to be in the public interest. We're a charity, and these are all these are all software projects that are committed to the ethical side of what they're doing. One of our projects is called Outreachy. It's an internship program. An internship program for women to women and other underrepresented groups to work on free and open source software. And what's cool is that, don't tell anyone. Hi, people who are watching this streaming. But we're about to announce tomorrow that this program is expanding to other underrepresented groups, including. So we basically I don't know if you guys saw all of the tech stats, the tech company stats that have come out in the last year, showing how much the tech corporate world is falling down on recruiting minorities. So we are basically responding to that and opening up our internship program to all of the categories that are on the bottom of that who are completely underrepresented. So we're opening up to all women globally, but in the US also men who are Black or African American, Latino Hispanic men, and also American Indians. So if you know people who are interested in this program, it's great. It's a very pragmatic program. We have about 40 free and open source software projects that participate on a cyclical basis, sometimes not every round, but for example, the Linux kernel participates in this, and there have been 24 women who are now kernel developers thanks to this program. And also Wikimedia, Mozilla, Debian and Fedora participate, GNOME. So it's a big program, and it's paid internships, so women and other underrepresented groups can get a real start. This is sort of off topic from what I'm my main topic of my talk, but if you have a free software project that's interested in joining, you should definitely come talk to me, or if you know talented women or other underrepresented people, you should definitely encourage them to sign up. Another thing that we're doing is we have the GPL compliance project for kernel developers. The Linux kernel developers who are very passionate about the GPL violations. Basically, free and open source software is everywhere. Despite the fact that in my talk I'm talking about all of these, you know, when I talk about medical devices and I talk about cars and I talk about voting machines and stock markets, despite the fact that these are all proprietary solutions and proprietary software companies that are doing it, there's tons of free and open source software underneath. Right? Free software has never been more successful. It's never been so prevalent, and yet our freedom is more elusive than ever because everything is wrapped in proprietary solutions. And the kernel developers that participate in our coalition are frustrated because they work on the Linux kernel because they're passionate about, about sharing their work. And the software that gets wrapped around, you know, there are companies that basically blatantly violate the GPL. So we help represent them with these companies and help encourage compliance and do a lot of work. And in March, we funded a lawsuit. This is Christoph Helwig, who is a kernel developer. He's always quite high in the kernel contribution stats as a code reviewer and as a contributor in the Linux kernel. And he filed a lawsuit in Germany against VMware because they had been creating a derivative work on the kernel. And so it'll be interesting to see how that plays out. And that's an ongoing suit in Germany. And that's something that we work on. And then we published copyleft.org, which is basically everything you'll ever want to know about the GPL and other copyleft licenses. And it, of course, is also copyleft. So if you have an interest in it, I encourage you to take a read, fix some typos, contribute, ask us questions, or things that you think need to be improved. And as part of that, we did a source review of this ThinkPenguin router to basically show companies what good compliance looks like. So, so that we take some of the mystery out of compliance and show what, you know, what needs to be done from the beginning. So the projects in conservancy are projects that respect user freedom. And software generally without surveillance, because of freedom open source software and freedom from surveillance are very friendly concepts and very linked. And having copyleft software helps ensure that you can protect yourself from surveillance because you can review the source code that's being used and patch it if you're not happy with what you see. Sometimes in my talks I ask, how many people in the audience have used Skype in the last, how many people here have used Skype or some other WhatsApp or some other proprietary communication for, it's almost everybody. At most of the times when I'm speaking, I know there are some hardcore people in here who are wise to this already, but you know, the NSA has known backdoors into Skype. It's one of those things where you're basically selling your privacy so cheaply for some convenience, and it's one of those things where it's like we as a society can make much better decisions. Software that's free and open has a much harder time pivoting away from social good, right? There's a whole pivot model of business model in software development where you build up a user base and then you pivot to something else, or you somehow exploit the user base in a way that they might not be aware of, or if they're aware of, they don't realize the dangers connected to it. Free and open source software helps protect against that. But we have a bootstrapping problem, right? Because if everybody here in this room has heard of Linux, has heard the word Linux, and almost everybody here is using proprietary software. Almost everyone in here is relying on it for important things and potentially making those decisions when there are other options that are available that may be a little bit less convenient. And it's one of those things where if we don't focus on improving these solutions, then we'll never get the people who are less tech savvy to sign on. We'll never improve them to the point. And I'm not saying everybody has to make the decision for themselves of where that line is. For me, I'm passionate about free and open source software. It's become so fundamental to who I am that my line is my defibrillator, right? And the radio bits on my phone. And I try to use free and open source software wherever I can. And if I interact with proprietary software, I try to really limit that. Everybody has to make the decision for themselves. You're all smart people, and you know, and what's convenient for some people are not for others. You know, my family is baffled that I won't use GPS, proprietary software. They're baffled at the times when I get lost or have to ask for directions on the street. And I understand that's not necessarily for everyone, but if we as a whole community started making some better choices and investing in the solutions that could get us to those better solutions, even if we're helping to invest in them so that we can use them in the future, we'll get there. And don't underestimate your power, because you're here. You're all savvy people who know that there's a problem, and you can help. And just asking questions like I did in the electrophysiologist's office of, have you thought about the software on these devices you're implanting, can really go a long way. 3 million people worldwide have pacemakers, and 600,000 every year are implanted, and about 20 million people in this country have some kind of implanted medical device. That's huge, and it just gets more and more every year. But you know what? If we're lucky, we're all going to be cyborgs. We're all headed in that direction. The technology is getting cheaper. They have pacemakers now that can be injected instead of implanted. They're so small, right? Defibrillator is not quite there yet, but it's going to become so cheap and so easy. The diagnostic tools are getting better. Most of us will. And you know, I acknowledge that the term cyborg is a little cheeky to describe myself. Anyone who has technology implanted in their body is technically a cyborg. We could argue that language is technology, or that our glasses make us cyborgs. It doesn't really matter. The point is that technology is going to be incorporated more fundamentally into who we are and how we interact with each other. And as time progresses, it's going to become more and more the case. So insist on ethical technology now, but most importantly for the infrastructure that's going to be built on it in the future. For your future cyborg self. And I would ask you all to become supporters. This is like a blatant sales pitch. A supporter of my organization, which is the Software Freedom Conservancy. Since we helped support the VMware suit, we've had some corporate funding pull, not surprisingly. Similarly, sometimes people don't quite like what we're doing in pushing diversity. Sometimes it turns out that when you push for ideology and you push for what's ethically right, it doesn't necessarily make the most popular corporate funding model, which means that we really need individuals to step up and help us close that gap. And of course, this, for everybody who saw this on streaming and for the video, this talk and the slides are all CC by SA, so feel free to make good use of that. And thank you.
All right, everyone, we're gonna have questions. If not, I'll start with one. I'm curious whether you, I guess a morbid curiosity, whether you have ever had a cause to have the defibrillator activate for cause, whether it has actually had to work or just accidents.
I have been shocked 3 times, and they have all been inappropriate. So the first time I was shocked because it was set way too sensitively. Like I had just gotten the device, and I was at the gym, and I was working out, and the defibrillator thought that my heart was beating twice as fast as it was. And so it shocked me. And I called the electrophysiologist, and it was so scary. And I called their office, and he was like, oh, yeah, because it's set so sensitively. Come on in. We'll get it adjusted. I was like, great, thanks. And then the other 2 times were when I was pregnant the last time. And pregnant women often have their heart race. And so I got shocked twice. And that is really, I'd say, really scary. And it's all been inappropriate.
And also in relation to the question of being able to modify the software, have you also thought about the process of upgrading and what would be required to make a device that was safe to upgrade and still testable while implanted and stuff like that?
Yeah, these devices are upgradable. Mine's upgradable now through magnetic coupling, which means that when you update my device, it means that they have this thing called a programmer. It looks like a giant mouse, and it like locks on to the defibrillator. It just gets a magnetic hold on it, like kind of locks into place, and then it can talk that way. But in order for magnetic coupling to work, you have to be very close. But I have family members who have the regular wireless defibrillators, and before they even sit down in the doctor's chair, their pulse has changed. So it's really crazy. So these devices are upgradable now. I mean, I think we need real security on these devices. We need, like, there's not even password protection on these things. Like, there's more password probably in, your random, your phone or anything than there is on these devices, which is insane.
We have a question in the back there.
Thanks very much. I'd like to ask if, in your interaction with not just Medtronic, but the other manufacturers, back to the Software Conservancy, has there been any indication of interest from that industry about starting to talk about open source software? Or is it only been the personal experience that you've had with the fight with Medtronic over trying to find out what the heck's running on what you've got inside you?
I encountered a lot of hostility, I've tried lots of different approaches. I don't know if you can tell, but I'm like an extremely optimistic and earnest person. And I just thought if I could just get the right person and explain why this is a problem, maybe we could have some progress. But there's really not a lot of incentive for these companies to do anything about it. I'm afraid there's going to have to be some kind of massive failure in order for that to happen. Or somehow I've had some headway with cardiologists because, as I said, they're really the consumers. So if I could get cardiologists to see that this is a problem and cardiologists keep asking for it, then that might be the way. I did have a lovely conversation with a lawyer at Medtronic quite recently who was going to try to push this, but he was like, well, you're unusual because usually when I talk to people like this, they're attacking my company, but you say that you really appreciate having your device. So, why don't we do a focus on you for the internal, publication about how happy you are with your device? And I was like, well, if we're talking about the issues, at play, then absolutely. But, you know, we can't gloss over the fact that this is a major problem. So, you know, it's tough. And now with the with our DMCA exemption request, I've only had a negative reaction from that. And couching of what we as a group of researchers want to do as completely malicious, whereas the group of us as researchers have published everything on safety. And in fact, all of the researchers who have shown these vulnerabilities in the devices have been very, very careful to publish limited information about what they found, to raise the alarm about the fact that there's a problem without disseminating information to help people who want to maliciously exploit those vulnerabilities.
I'm going to ask a question while I'm walking this over. I'll give it right to you. Do you know if these companies consider the software to be core to their business as opposed to the actual medical device? Because what puzzles me is it seems like, for the most part, the description of the device should match what the software is and should be fairly obvious.
So you're asking, like, right in this. So I think that medical devices are the perfect example of what would be a very successful business model for free and open source software, because nobody chooses their medical device based on, like, the software being fancy, right? They choose these devices based on the fact that the company has a very long manufacturing history, right? Like, I would want Medtronic to be producing my pacemaker defibrillator. If Nokia decided to go into the, you know, the device manufacturing business tomorrow, I'd be very skeptical. I'd say, oh, I'm going to wait a decade to see how they do before I switch to them, right? It's precision manufacturing, right? It's actually having this equipment that makes these devices perfect every time. And then it's the doctor support network. It's classic business model for free and open source software, precision manufacturing, support. So they're really the only really good explanation that I have heard for why the device manufacturers are so reluctant to publish their source code is that they're worried about patent trolls or patent attack. Because they're worried that, well, for two things. One is that if they publish their source code, people will see how ugly it is. I'm sure, I've talked to developers at some of these companies who have said things like, well, if you saw the comments in the code that never got cleaned up, you know, they'd have to really, and it's a real process to clean up code to make it suitable for other people to see it. And so that's an expense they don't want to undertake. But then also, if they publish the source code, then other companies will look and see if they feel like they're violating their software patents, which is really horrible. Like the idea that software patent, the threat of software patents would be so great that you wouldn't, you know, publish the source code is—it's like the total opposite of what the patent system is supposed to do.
How much does a defibrillator cost, and have you been able to purchase any of these to reverse engineer them, or has anyone else?
So my bill was like $90,000. No, the equipment itself are like tens of thousands of dollars. They're really expensive. People on the, like, there are all these support forums for patients. Like, there's one called the Zap Forum. And people on these forums call these their internal bling because they're so expensive. I think they're not necessarily as high as $90,000. It really depends. And overseas, the bills come in much, much lower. But so I did have a defibrillator roll off a truck and into my possession. But I'm a lawyer, and I don't feel comfortable reverse engineering something that is clearly not intended for me to have access to. I want to be doing this the right way. I want people to understand that there are risks, and I want, and that's why it was great that there are people like Barnaby Jack and the academic consortium who are able to get these devices and show their vulnerabilities.
One further question from me is, it sounds like maybe this is a regulatory affair. Sometimes when you hit a note with me, I'm a pilot, and there's some software in planes that's really fancy, and pilots buy it because it looks really cool. But in commercial aircraft flying passengers for hire, there's an awful lot of software in there that has to meet a federal specification the FAA has called TSOs. It's not because it's fancy, it's because the autopilot has to work. And so it goes through extensive testing. Sounds like the FDA is not interested in anything beyond the manufacturer's assurance that this thing works without knowing the insides of it. Is it because this is a paradigm change for the FDA about actually even thinking about the software? Because seems to me this device is nothing but software.
It's a very much a paradigm shift in the FDA to really be considering software. That the head of cybersecurity, when I was on that panel, he said the FDA doesn't have the resources to be looking, reviewing the software of all of these devices. We're a small agency, we just don't have funding for that. And he stopped in the middle and he said, but what you're saying is that we shouldn't do it. You're saying everyone else should do it. That is interesting. And so it's a really like fascinating thing, but you know, it's gonna take time, and the problem is that people are so hyped up about cybersecurity and vulnerabilities and protecting people from evil hackers, right? That they lose the plot and they aren't thinking rationally, they're not looking at these security studies that show, you know, that free and open source software is safer and better. And they're in that weird, completely unreasonable mode of we have to protect ourselves and we have to limit control, limit access. And it's very, very dangerous. And as I said, we're going to have, it really makes me sick to think about it, but we're going to have some major failure before we learn as a society.
My question's kind of tangentially related to that. Is there anywhere at the FDA where, you know, we can kind of advocate for them to improve regulation or add some regulations in this area? Like, I actually have a heart difficulty too, and I may have a pacemaker at some point as well. So, you know, some blatant self-interest, but.
Yeah, no, I mean, I think there you can contact your congressman and alert them to the issue and tell them that it's important. I at one time had been circulating petitions for people to sign. I'm convinced that without elevating this to a much higher level of, you know, of attention in society, I'm actually kind of burnt out in thinking that we can solve this in such a straightforward way, and instead think that it's probably better to focus on patients and cardiologists, you know, talk about it as much as possible. I mean, since I started talking about this, at least there have been some really cool TV plots based on it, Homeland and NCIS, and because of that, I think that, and maybe this is indirectly through my advocacy, I'm not sure, you never know, but I was the first person to start talking about this, and Dick Cheney now has had the wireless functionality on his defibrillator turned off, which is... well, you know, when I first started giving this talk, I could say, you know, that Dick Cheney had no pulse, because he had this really special device where it was like a constant circulation of blood, and so he had no pulse, but now he has a regular defibrillator. But he had the wireless turned off, which is very helpful, because now that he insisted on it, when other patients ask for their wireless functionality to be disabled in hardware, the medical device manufacturers will do it, which is major progress. I'm really excited about that. Chances are my defibrillator is going to run out of battery in the next year or two, and I'm so relieved because there are no more older devices that are still sterile that I can get like I did the last time, and they all have the wireless functionality.
Yeah. So is it worth it for the companies to actually offer out the software? Okay, so I first heard about the Bluetooth, as a Bluetooth vulnerability, I guess about a couple years ago, and in the defibrillators. And if you had the software and it had been checked, and all of a sudden they say, oh, now there's a Bluetooth, and oh, there's Bluetooth here, it would be completely, you know, you could be checking and you say, well, now I don't want to buy these from this company ever again. Okay.
Yeah, I mean, free and open source software is not necessarily safer or better, right? But it means that you can check it yourself, and it means that, you know, groups can be auditing software for safety, which is really valuable. I think that's exactly right. Most companies don't, I mean, unless they're using GPL code, which many do because it's so useful, you know, there's so much useful code. And then most companies start out with violations, so they're not publishing all their source code. but there are many companies that get it right, and one of the things that we try to do at Conservancy is to work with companies when we see a violation and help them see how to come into compliance in a really positive, friendly way. And we hopefully never get to lawsuits. It's just we spent 4 years working with VMware, and they failed to. Eventually, they said we believe we're in compliance, and we said we disagree. You know, and at that point, you have to bring a lawsuit. But there's a lot of unless they're using the GPL, it's very hard to compel companies to release source code if they don't have to, because they're worried you might find a vulnerability. But I would be worried that someone wouldn't find a vulnerability and then people die, personally.
I just have a statement and a question. One is basically on the open source. This was an argument that I was actually having with someone, and this is the example that they gave me. They said if you have a secure building and you just bring in 100 people expecting that they will find security weakness, that's bad. You know, you shouldn't let anybody inside so it'll be more secure. I'm like, this is not a building, this is a software, you know? So that was one thing that, you know, I found that people are thinking, you know, this is how they compare software. They think that, you know, open sourcing software is like letting people walk into a secure building. And the question I have is, why don't you just get all these patients who, I honestly don't believe doctors are going to have the best intention. As long as they're getting commission from these manufacturers, they're going to shut their mouth. Why don't you just get all these patients in a room and, you know, just walk around with your iPhone and tell them, is this your social security number? I'm sure they will start talking and they will start nagging their doctors.
So on your first point, Brazil did something really cool. They, for their voting machine software, they invited teams of hackers to come and find vulnerabilities. And they offered cash prizes to the teams that found vulnerabilities. And two teams found vulnerabilities. One was a real vulnerability, the other was maybe, but they gave the prize to both teams. And it's sort of like harnessing this idea to, you know, and giving prizes in order to help make the software more secure. On the second thing, when I started posting, I published my paper and I never talked about having having a medical condition myself. And I published this paper, and then I posted on the pacemaker forums, I posted the link to the paper, and the response I got was, you're trying to scare us. You don't know what it's like to live with a defibrillator and to have your life rely on this medical device. And I don't want to hear it because I need this device to live. And if my doctor tells me it's safe, it's safe. And you need to get out of our forum because you don't belong here. And that's when I realized that I had to start talking about my own situation as a patient, even though I hate doing it. And it's tough because patients, the people who need devices, and it's changing a little bit because people like me, there's another guy, Hugo Campos, who has my very same heart condition, and he's in his 40s, and he advocates for patient access to data. And so it's like the other side of the same coin. And it, more people who are technically savvy will get these devices. As a technically savvy population age, more of us have access to this technology, I think more of these issues will come up. But it's hard to get patients to band together because they don't want to think about it. They'll call their doctors, and their doctors will say, no, it's safe. And because what are they going to say? I mean, I don't want to scare people. They don't want to scare people. And there's a cognitive dissonance because you need this piece of equipment. And that's why I think there need to be vulnerabilities and failures. I think someone had their hand up right behind you. Not with a tremendous amount of interest. I mean, most of the researchers that are involved in this space have some kind of implanted device. There was the panel, the head of cybersecurity at the FDA had hearing implants. And then there were three other people on the panel, and the other two had insulin pumps. So it's quite common.
Okay, for the FDA to say that they don't know how to deal with this, that would be a lie because, I mean, I'm saying that I think that would be just very short-sighted of them because the FCC has a site, fcc.io, and you can actually put any FCC ID there and you can get information about your device, whatever it is. But that is because it would be, because it's FCC, it means any wireless device, anything that uses radio communications. So the same process could be used for software on these medical devices.
Yeah, I think you make an excellent point. There's some information that is available on the FDA website, the hardware trials. There's some information that's available about this, but not any of the source code. And convincing them that it's a good idea to publish source code is a tremendous hurdle and needs to come from a societal shift in understanding about how vulnerable proprietary software is over time.
Yeah, go ahead. You have a mic?
Hi. So as a fellow lawyer...
There are a bunch of lawyers in the room, actually. You're surrounded.
Who's not wearing a t-shirt and shorts?
So I'm familiar with a lot of the routes of negotiating with businesses or lawsuits or filing petitions for DMCA exemptions and that sort of thing. But I'm actually really, really interested in what successes you have had with the other route of people. and particularly cardiologists, number two, and other patients. And I know that not everybody has responded positively, but I'm just curious, particularly in this area, what you found people did respond to, besides horrific destruction and what you unfortunately think may have to happen for broad social change, but just...
on the individual level, yeah. It's amazing, right? Like, people hear me talk about this and they say, of course, like, this is such a big deal. And particularly cardiologists, electrophysiologists, they're very smart people. And they're not necessarily people who have thought about, they're not necessarily super technologically savvy. So some people get really, like, they get a wall up because they say, you're telling me that what I'm doing is dangerous and I'm trying to help people. And, you know, and I sort of explained, no, actually, I'm really glad for what you do, but there's this whole layer of safety you should be demanding that you're not already demanding. So I've had a lot of really great, actually, every time I've been shocked, and every time I go into the hospital for a checkup or anything, I'm always like, what opportunity do I have to talk to somebody else today? and things like what Barnaby Jack did, which really raised the level, So him hearing this talk and me talking about it generally on, I have an podcast called Freeze and Freedom, and he was actually a listener, which really blew my mind, because when you record one of those things, you think, nobody listens to this. and then to have something so productive come out of it. So that's been pretty good. And then we've had some really good response to the DMCA exception request process too. And so I'm, you know, crossing my fingers that we'll get a good result when they finally resolve that. But the advocacy component of it has been really good. And so, you know, I can't point to any real sweeping successes in terms of like broader change, but on an individual level, there have been a lot of small successes that have been extremely encouraging. Oh, and an academic program that's being developed to basically review software on these medical devices. So that's pretty cool too.
So how many times has, like, putting security aside, how many times has a software bug led to a malfunction that caused, like, serious harm or death? Like, the only instance of this that I maybe have heard of was an X-ray machine that I think was misconfigured.
Therac 25.
The what?
The Therac.
The Therac, yeah. But that was a misconfiguration, right? That wasn't a software bug. So I'm wondering, like, if you have different counts for those.
It was classic. I don't remember the details exactly of it, but it was classic. It was described to me as a classic. Actually, when I went to engineering school, we had an introductory class called To Engineer as Human. And it was like the freshman year engineer, and I split mechanical and electrical basically. And like the first class we took was basically studying famous engineering failures. And that was one of like the famous failures. So some of the bugs that have come up that were software related, not necessarily bugs, but things that are configure related, which are effectively software bugs too. So for example, insulin pumps where technicians thought they were entering doses in hours, but we're in fact entering it in minutes. That was a big one. Recently, like a couple of years ago, there was another a total just software bug where in these pacemakers, one of the ways that if in a defibrillator, if you're getting shocked, a way to disable it is to put a very strong magnet on top of it. That's sort of, and EMTs have strong magnets because sometimes these devices malfunction or the patient's heart rhythm is in such a way that they just keep getting shocked over and over and over and over again. There was one guy on the pacemaker forum who said he was shocked 40 times. And so having a magnet to just stop it once they're in care, you know, and have the ability, access to it, it's really, but there was one software bug where they, where when they had done that and they had removed the magnet, the device still thought that the magnet had been applied. And so people had left care with their defibrillators or pacemakers not functioning properly, still disabled. So there are a lot of examples. There haven't been, happily, a lot of deaths from defibrillator malfunctions or pacemaker malfunctions. More of the harm that is quantifiable has been in the insulin pump space. And then there have been some pain management device failures as well. So you can look at, Mm-hmm. Yeah. So you can look at a paper I wrote called "Kill by Code," that collects all of this. It's a few years old now, so it's somewhat old, but the stats are still pretty vivid.
But it does sound like a lot of those are configuration problems, right?
Some of them are configuration. Some of them are software bugs.
But isn't it true that software ought to be able to prevent a stupid mistake, like a technician setting it for per minute instead of per hour. I mean, unless you're connected to a Rhino, you don't need that much insulin.
Not without code review and requirements set to do that.
Yep, and hey, 98% of software failures in that study that were where there were recalls could have been prevented with all-pair testing, with multiple conditions being tested for that hadn't been tested for.
Right.
Are all of these devices manufactured in the United States? Because you talk about the FDA a lot, and I'm wondering if other jurisdictions might be more amenable to making the code more available.
Every jurisdiction I've researched has been sort of similar in terms of their, I haven't done an exhaustive search from country to country, but I've given this talk in a lot of countries, and getting back to my internship program for women and other underrepresented groups, I have imposter syndrome. So every time I go to give this device, this talk, despite the fact that how many cyborg lawyers are there in the world, right? How many patients with defibrillators who are lawyers who have engineering backgrounds are there? Despite that, every time I get up to give this talk, I think, oh no, what if somebody asks me a question? I don't know. In which case, the answer is, well, I don't know. That's a great question. But so every time I give this talk in a country, a new country, I, the night before, freak out and do research in that country because, of course, it's very important. I know exactly what their Food and Drug Administration or equivalent says. And so far, and every time I've researched it, it's been the same. I haven't found any exceptions yet. I'm sure there are some jurisdictions that would be more amenable to different approach, but right now most of the very strong medical device manufacturers are controlled. They're not all the manufacturing has taken place in where they're controlled, but they're controlled by U.S. and European entities.
My question was kind of on the heels of that last question, and you know, I'm kind of a libertarian mindset that the FDA prevents people from getting cheap solutions. Most people don't agree with me, but in this room, maybe there's a higher percentage. But around the world, do you see any open source, because I know in the US it wouldn't be legal, but open source solutions for medical devices like the ones you have and others?
There have been. There actually are a couple of really cool initiatives around the insulin pump space. So there's actually one initiative where this guy was so frustrated, he had a, because his daughter has type 1 diabetes, and he felt like, you know, when you know for kids, controlling their blood sugar levels precisely is really important because over time, if it's not controlled well, they'll have more, you know, it'll control the damage that's done. And so he was finding that the information he knew about his child's lifestyle was so detailed, and he could really help her in a way that the devices were not allowing him to. So he started an initiative to create new software for insulin pumps. So there's some cool stuff happening in that space. But I know of other initiatives outside the United States, but they're not generally in implanted devices, the ones that I'm aware of. They're in like hospital equipment. I mean, hospital equipment is riddled with malware. Right, they have this old, they have proprietary software, and then when the hospitals can't afford to upgrade to their new licenses, they basically keep the old equipment, which then has all kinds of backdoors in it. There was one study that showed that this guy went in and he was able to like control multiple critical systems in hospitals quite readily within a very short period of time.
I worked at a hospital and I had that very experience. I was on the security team and I found Solaris boxes that had radiology images readily open, and they said, well, you can't touch them because they're HIPAA-compliant devices. And then you would have to have special software, which is freely available online to read these images. But you have to do a Google search or something to find it.
Yeah. So there are some, you know, there are some initiatives to deal with that software because it's sort of like low-hanging fruit in a way that can really benefit everybody.
Question from earlier. Go ahead.
So you had mentioned having more success kind of at an individual level, like convincing people of why this is. But I'd imagine a lot of your talks are in rooms full of geeks who are like kind of get this, or they're there to hear you talk about these things. But is there something in between pure open source lifestyle, no GPS, and my mom, real world examples I could give to somebody who doesn't care if the NSA is listening to Skype, but this can give us a better, like what examples can I give someone about how this makes a better world that doesn't care about geek stuff?
Yeah, I mean, so I've been sort of focusing on trying to get the message out to non-free and open source software core audiences. So for example, I gave this talk at South by Southwest, technologically savvy, but not necessarily as entrenched in free and open source software. I want our moms and dads who are maybe less, our grandfathers who are less technologically savvy to understand these issues too. But there are all kinds of free and open source software projects that that people are using already and that you can sort of introduce to them one at a time. You know, you can use Talkie.io or some one of the other free video chat services, and sort of what's nice about those is they're not keeping, you know, at least they're making representations about not keeping track of you. You don't need an account in order to use them. Sort of introducing one thing at a time. I definitely think that, as I said, everybody draws the line where they're comfortable with, and what is right for one person to another. Technology is a very personal choice, and people who are interested in free and open source software are really into choice, and you should be, because that's one of the really cool things about free and open source software, is that you have control of it. You can use what you want, not use what you don't want to use. But there has to, so I'm trying to find ways to get more in that middle ground, and if you have any ideas later, you should let me know.
Question back here.
Okay, I was looking into different medical devices, personal, I just like researching them. So,
cool.
So I was looking into some like EEGs, and there's some that are used for people with epilepsy. There's some that are ambulatory, which means that they'll record 72 hours instead of, you know, in a hospital and all that.
Like, but they're very expensive. Monitor.
And they're very old, yes. So I was looking into these, and then I wanted to look what they allow here in the U.S., and then looking at European and Asian companies. And a lot of the European and Asians were not allowed in the U.S., but they would sell them to you if it was for entertainment purposes only.
Well, people really use these things for entertainment purposes.
Yeah, well, I kind of do, but still.
They do. You know, it's interesting. I really feel like we're so on the cusp of great change, because there's so many projects that are developing, like, a lot of portable, lightweight, cheap technology that's diagnostic and other technology. You know, like, there's... At the bar, if you come, I'm not going to be drinking, obviously, but I it's a more fitting place to tell you some of the off-color stories of what people do with some of these things. It's really fascinating. And I think, and this is the reason why I want to get the message out about free and open source software, is because all these things are being built with, like, VC funding in mind, and then the VC funding insists that you hold whatever patents you can and you keep control of whatever software you can, without thinking of the implications down the road and how these devices are going to be used and what their potential is.
Great talk. So apparently during the recent unintended acceleration problem with Toyotas, there was a big discovery phase, and some experts got to look at the source code. And long story short, apparently, whether it was at fault or not, the code was not very good. So I have to wonder if like, the overwhelming motivation isn't really patents or trade secrets, but like a quality type of issue. So I'm imagining you're calling around and you're like, oh, I'm a lawyer and I do, you know, copyleft enforcement or something like that. And I want to see
that.
Your source code. I don't think that's going to be something they're really going to jump at. What do you think?
I did have early on an electrophysiologist hang up on me because of that. You know, I said, he knew I was a lawyer. He's like, you're a lawyer, you're trying to trap me in something. And I was like, no, I'm really scared. Like, I'm really scared about my own health. And he said, well, if you decide to get the device, I'll help you, but I don't trust that you're trying to do some kind of gotcha. So I found another electrophysiologist. I went through a couple of electrophysiologists. But the breathalyzer cases are really interesting to look at. So I don't know if you guys know about that, but there was a spate of cases in a lot of different jurisdictions where people were pulled over for drunk driving. And they had these breathalyzers. And so there was a seminal case brought where the alleged drunk driver said, I want to see the source code on my breathalyzer because I should be able to see my accuser. And how do I know? Like, I wasn't drunk. So, and this breathalyzer says I was. Why do you trust this breathalyzer? And we should submit the source code into evidence in the court. In that particular case, the source code was submitted as evidence. And there are different, same case has been brought in a lot of different jurisdictions because drunk drivers in many different countries, very different states were saying, oh, or alleged drunk drivers were saying, oh, you know, maybe. And what they found in that particular case was that the software was buggy. And so the case got thrown out. And so in other states, and so some states allow, some states didn't. I don't think there's been any resolution on a national level, but it's really interesting stuff. And what they found was that the software wasn't reliable. And people had been getting convicted based on that software.
So this is a related question. So as software people who are active with Linux, I suspect that we generally agree that in the broad case, security through obscurity is not, it doesn't typically lead to more security. With nuances, but that seems to be a generally supportable stance among engineers and people working in technology. But for lawyers, and I'm wondering what the best legal advice would be and how the legal system generally treats disclosures of information. Could a device manufacturer potentially be liable for, let's say they publish the source code to one of these things, and that publication leads to a vulnerability? Now, as engineers, we might think that vulnerability eventually would have been discovered regardless of the release of the source code, but conceivably somebody might make some kind of a legal argument that it was discovered now because the source code was released and somebody was able to look at the source code, the published source code, and spot it. Does that potentially make a company more liable through the eyes of the law?
Can I actually phrase what I think is your question a little bit differently? And tell me if you agree with this, but if you were an officer of that company and they were legal officer, what would you do in order to both protect the company and do what you think is right?
Do you think that encompasses? These are really good questions, and it was interesting having discussions with lawyers in medical device companies and in other safety critical companies. So, for example, in automotive. And things like that. And my argument is simply, we need real security. We need real security and open source, like free and open source software, right? So we need encryption and password. Like we need real protection on these devices so that not everyone can just update them, right? We need like actual security while still having the source code reviewed. And those two things are completely, like I want to have access to the source code, but I don't, like, I want to be able to choose who updates my own device, right? So, I mean, this is one of those things. And the lawyers in these companies struggle with these really complex issues. And depending on what space they're in, the regulations are all very different. And I want to, I oversimplify things a little bit in this talk to get the point across. But the truth is that showing how many vulnerabilities there have been from proprietary software and closed source software shows that these things are not necessarily connected. So no one wants to be the first one to go, to publish their source code. And they say, oh, there could be legal risk. We don't know, so we don't want to do it. And this is part of why advocating with governmental agencies can be very helpful. There are so many pieces to this puzzle. And it would make a great novel.
So you mentioned the FDA in that panel with the cyber whatever. From the FBA, FDA.
Oh, the head of cybersecurity?
Yeah. So they don't have funding to do all these checks. But we are on the brink of a revolution where we will have a ton of medical devices, either directed or at least connected to phones and other stuff, IoT, whatever. So if they don't have the resources to check, devices from medical companies, how they're going to do anything with this? I mean, what's their plan?
Yeah.
Do they have a plan at all?
What they do is they have companies design their own tests. So like they basically, and there are actually some good arguments for doing it that way, right? Like every device is different, and to make a clear set of requirements on a piece of software is tough. And when all the different devices are so different, and in some ways the manufacturers themselves are the best ones to know what testing needs to be done on that particular device. It just doesn't hold up, right? So right now, the FDA published an advisory to companies saying that cybersecurity is a real problem, and you should be aware of it, and you should do things to actively prevent against exploitation.
I mean, I can understand that with big companies like Medtronic that have a reputation. They probably do testing, I'm sure. But
oh, they do. Well, they don't. I mean, they don't want people to be dying from there.
With the broadening of the platform, there will be any kind of, you know, snake oil company that will say, you know, this is great and it's completely untested stuff. So if the FDA just trusts anybody telling them this is great, I mean,
yeah, there's basically a committee that reviews all the testing done and determines whether or not the tests themselves that have been done on each device are adequate. I filed a Freedom of Information Act request with respect to my own device. With respect to my dad's device, and because I wanted one with a wireless component. And it was basically, it was so many pages, and it was so hard to basically get them. They sent me the committee minutes. and I was like, well, that's not very helpful. It was really an interesting experiment. And basically the committee, it depends on how savvy the committee is. And they basically, but there is process to look at the tests and determine whether the tests that have been done are adequate. It just, to me, if researchers can't explore the code and test it for vulnerabilities, and if we as the public, you know, if there's catastrophic failure at Medtronic, I'm up the creek, right? Like, I've got a device that's worthless, basically, and that's just not, doesn't make a lot of sense.
So you have a question over here.
You mentioned VMware and its lack of compliance with the GPL. Here's another company, Cloud Engines. They do the Pogo plug, and they're using GPL software to run it. And at one point, they made it available for download, then withdrew it, and they tried to dissuade users from trying to get their plugs to do something else that's also open source based.
If you know of a violation that you want to report, there you can email compliance@sfconservancy.org. sfconservancy.org.
So I think we've got through most of the questions. If does anyone have any last questions, I'll take one more. Two more. So I saw his hand first. I guess we can do two if you're okay with it?
Yeah.
Two seems like a reasonable number.
I was almost getting a chair, but two I think I can.
Okay.
I note that the FDA has a concept of unqualified versus qualified software guidelines in terms of what the companies have to follow for their SDLC. And I know that they prefer big vendors because they can afford the certifications to use software to help build more qualified systems. What kind of process do you think should be done to get more open source software sort of qualified to be used in these type of systems?
Yeah, I mean, honestly, I think it's pretty clear that if I had my way, all software would be free and open. So particularly for life and society critical software, I think it should be mandated to be free and open. But short of that, which I'm not so naive to think that I'm going to wake up tomorrow and wake up in a world where that's the way it is. I just think that we need to raise awareness and get some companies to realize that there's a market and a marketing base around the idea that their software is better because it's free and open. And I think that's the way we're going to get there.
Yeah. So this is a more personal thing. It sounded like in a year and a half, you're going to have to get a new device. And it sounded like you're going to have to get one that has wireless capability. And you're probably not going to have the software to take a look at. Is the type of thing that you're hoping to have is that you will have a password to be able to get to that device. And that when someone says, now we want to adjust it, and he says, password is whatever your password is. I don't know what, 13 random characters, whatever. Okay. And so that you're in control of the actual changes to the device and or when it's going to occur?
So it's right. These are really complicated questions. In a year and a half or whenever it is that I have to get my new device, I'm really hoping I can get the wireless component disabled, which it sounds like in hardware, it sounds like I'll be able to do. So that's the way I'm going. Especially the crowds I hang around with, like, really want to get that disabled. Yeah, I want somebody to be putting something right here for me to know that they're talking to my device. on the password question, that's not necessarily the easiest way to have security on these devices, because if the patient passes out and needs critical treatment, is that so these are tough. There are a lot of different ways that you can employ the security. It could be on a piece of equipment you keep with you, or there could be password registries. There could be all different kinds of things that are valid solutions to this. And you know, I hope that in a year and a half we have, and I think we are likely to have real encryption, real security on these devices. I just worry that it will be then a felony to be going around it to check and see if the software is safe.
All right, that's all the questions. We have trivia, so we'll give it 5 minutes. Oh, yeah. Did you think of some questions?
Yes.
All right, so we have these books and vouchers up here. I will just lay them out here for whoever can answer the questions. Just a quick rundown. There are three books. There are three book vouchers. If you win, you can come look at them.
Thank you.
Oh, yeah.
Thanks so much. Okay, so how about the Software Engineering Institute estimates that one bug is introduced for every how many lines of code?
You in the blue shirt right here, I saw first. That sounded like what I saw on the slides. Come on up and grab a book. By the way, yeah, please raise your hand. Don't shout out, because I'm going to pick whoever I pick, they're it no matter what. So don't give them the answer. Right?
Name three member projects of the Software Freedom Conservancy.
I saw both of you. Who wants to do it? All right, fair enough. If you want to split the rewards, go for it. All right.
Yeah. All right.
I saw those three. just take one that you guys want to split. You want half of the trivia book? All right. Next question?
Next question. I'm just going to look at my slides and come up with one. Oh, can you name two projects participating in Outreachy? Yes.
All right, come on up. That was great. You have a trove of these things that you know.
Oh.
It's true. You could ask about groups who can participate and.
How about how many lines of code does a premium class car have?
Wait, you already won, so you can put your hand down. You are there.
Yes. Is there more? Do I need more questions?
You need at least two more, yeah.
Okay. Did I go ahead?
Yeah, shoot.
The honeymoon effect. Does that, studies the number of what in a piece of software? Yes. Boy, attentive audience. And what's the relationship?
It's like a honeymoon. All right, next.
Oh, how long is the honeymoon in a honeymoon effect? That's kind of a tricky one.
All right. Okay, give it a shot.
Right.
Beautiful. Come on up.
Yeah, it's indeterminate, right? We don't know. It's different for every piece of software. And that's it, right?
That's it. You've cleared it out.
Yes.